King's Cross is located in central London, a mile and a half north of Charing Cross. For several years, King's Cross was central London's poorest district, firmly aligned with prostitution, drugs, and homelessness. Naturally, the area then saw a decline in regards to railway goods, especially to the north of the station and the neighbouring regions. This forced the introduction of heavy policing, along with CCTV working to eliminate the unsavoury practices. Lasting reputation still gave way to cheaper rents, attracting a slew of artists and designers into the district. The turnaround from improvements made over the years to King's Cross has seen the likes of Facebook and Sky place offices here. Oh, and a company called Google. King's Cross St Pancras is the busiest and most well-connected interchange of the entire London Underground network of 270 stations. At peak times, more than 550 tube trains are in operation across the 11 coloured tube lines, six of which pass through here. Interestingly, the station has a platform that non-magical people can't see, called Platform 9 and 3 quarters, with a single express train stopping at some sort of school called Hogwarts. A student named Harry Potter previously left his trolley here, and it's become a popular feature people queue up to observe. St Pancras International of 1868 has been home to Eurostar since 2007, along with a collection of shops, restaurants, and Europe's longest champagne bar. William Barlow originally designed a single terminus on Euston Road to run from Bedford to London, but you can now travel directly to Belgium, France, the Netherlands, as well as various corners of England. The frontage of the station is a jaw-droppingly gothic display of beauty as the 300-room St Pancras Renaissance Hotel. George Gilbert Scott submitted this Victorian palace design with 150 bedrooms, but the Midland Railway Company were so taken with his ideas, they doubled down on them for a much bigger and more expensive feat. Most rooms are about £250 a night, but the Royal Suite is 10 grand a night. This is reasonable, considering it recently cost £47,000 just to reapply wallpaper to one of the rooms. Granary Square is a large public space, roughly equal to the size of Trafalgar Square, and has become the beating heart of the district. The actual square lies in front of the Granary Building, originally conceived in 1852 by Lewis Cubitt as a useful place to unload goods from barges. The building is now a campus of UAL, University of the Arts, London. After redevelopment of the area, Granary Square opened in 2012 with a large water installation feature. A display of 1,000 small fountain jets are used mostly by families with young children to cool down and have some fun in the sun. This spot hosts a range of art, culture and sport events, music and even ice cream festivals. As you walk through Granary Square, you'll notice restaurants conveniently placed for watching the view as you dine out. If you're not fancying a bite to eat, a greenery section by the canal has been created where people chill with friends, read by the water, or enjoy film viewings from a screen across the canal. Walking down the slope or steps near Granary Square beside the greenery seating reveals the towpath along the canal, which follows through with an inviting view of the boats. Wandering further along will eventually lead you to Word on the Water. This floating bookshop on Regent's Canal has been here since 2011, well, kind of. When they arrived then, canal regulations ordered them to relocate every 2 weeks. A mixture of squatting for 6 months straight and public outcry from a successful campaign of supporters forced the Canal Trust to finally relent and offer the boat a permanent berth. New and used titles are all accessible to browse in this cosy 1920s Dutch barge, whilst a soothing soundtrack of water and music emits in the background. Customers are very welcome to enter, get comfortable and page turn beside the wood-burning stove. The boat hosts talks on the arts, technology, feminism and politics, and puts on musical performance and open mic nights. These wrought iron frames you can see were gas holders from the 1850s, in use up until the year 2000. They'd store and transfer gas as part of the Pancras gasworks. The restoration of each holder required 20-ton cranes painstakingly dismantling and transporting the structures piece by piece over to Yorkshire and back for renovation. The largest one frames a local space aptly titled Gas Holder Park, and the others have been reused to create apartments beside the park as designed by Wilkinson Air Architects. King's Cross was the name of a monument erected in 1830 to commemorate the recent passing of George IV. The local community found the placement of this structure very impractical since it was awkwardly blocking ongoing traffic, and as a result, it was finally destroyed 15 years later. By the time that happened, however, the area had already taken on the name of that unsatisfying statue, as well as the shiny new train station opening to the public in 1852. Possibly the most relaxing part of this 1819 built waterway channel running between Paddington and Limehouse comes in the form of St Pancras Lock. A traditional and well protected cottage is located on an island by the lock, originally used as a station for water pumping before becoming a home for the lock keeper in 1926. The directors of this decided to have all the locks paired, so water was saved and transferred between the locks instead of having water discharged into empty locks. Railways were becoming popular to use, which saw a decline in the use of the canal, so lockkeepers decided to install padlocks to prevent locks being used on the weekends. After a while, demands for leisure boating began to grow once again, with the locks being operated by boat crews.